All right, if you have your Bible, which I hope you do, please open to Colossians chapter 2, verse 6. Colossians chapter 2, verse 6. It's going to take us a while to get there. We're going to look at a couple other passages. I'll throw those up on the screen, but that's where we'll end up. Sometimes I drive my vehicle without paying close attention. I don't know if anyone else does this. I'm not an outrageous offender. I don't text and drive at the same time. But I can drift while I'm driving. And sometimes my driving gets sloppy as a result. This is exactly what happened. A number of years ago, I was driving on Rosemead just south of the church here. And as I was driving along, my mind started to drift, which unfortunately led to my car starting to drift from the right lane to the left lane. That wouldn't have been that big of a deal. The problem was, at the exact same moment, a police officer was driving an outrageous speed in the left lane, and I veered into his path. He slammed on the brakes to miss me. Red lights started to flash in my rearview mirror. A story about his coffee spilling on his lap was told. My inquiries concerning his rate of speed were ignored. A ticket was issued. All because I wasn't paying attention. I drifted. Sometimes I read the Bible without paying close attention, too. I'm not an outrageous offender. I don't watch TV while I'm reading the Bible. But my mind drifts, and my reading gets sloppy. And I can actually read an entire text, close the Bible, and have no idea what I just read. I don't know if anyone can relate or not. The problem is we don't have any public servants patrolling our quiet times, giving us tickets for being inattentive. And so we can go years and years and years and not really read the Bible. If you struggle staying focused while reading your Bible, in fact, let's just have a time. Raise your hand if you ever struggle staying focused when you're reading the Bible. If your hand is up, this sermon is for you. This sermon is for you. I think it will help. Because if you want to hear God speak to you, you have to learn to see what you read. You have to learn to observe. My minor indiscretion on Rosemead landed me in what we call in Texas in defensive driving. I had already done it a number of times. I didn't want to do it again, so I went to comedy defensive driving. I don't know if you've ever done that or not. They discovered early on that I was a pastor, and so it was just brutal all day long. Oh, we've got a pastor at defensive driving, and they just ripped on me the whole time. At one point, our leader, who was a comedian, said, you know what, if you're going to learn to drive, you have to learn to observe. You have to be able to see things. So he said, let's play a game. And he got a little tray. We were in a restaurant. And he asked a young woman who was part of the group to stand up and walk around and have people put things on the tray. He said, now I want you to observe. Observe as much as you can. And so we're all watching what everyone's putting on the tray. And there's pens, and somebody threw his wallet on there. And there's keys and just tons of junk on the tray. And he said, pay very close attention. And so we're all just staring at it, trying to remember everything that's on the tray. And he said, then please go ahead and go out. So the young lady went out, and they closed the door behind her. And then he said, now take the 3x5 card in front of you, and what I want you to do is I want you to write down everything you observed about the young woman holding the tray. And I'm looking around like, actually, I looked at Libby. She was there with me that day. She had a minor infraction as well. I said, I wasn't looking at her. I was looking at the tray. She said, just go ahead and write down. And so I just wrote a couple things on the card and put my name on it, and we handed them in. And she came back in. He said, let's see how we did. And the young woman stands up, and she says, I want to know what the pastor wrote. And I looked at Libby and said, oh, no. And so he went through the stack of cards, and he found mine. There were only two things written on it. They're the only two things I noticed. The first was dark roots. The second was worse. Her jeans are way too tight, I wrote on there. If I had known that we were supposed to observe her and write those things on the card, I would have come up with much better stuff. But I didn't know what I was supposed to be looking at. Please hear me. If you're going to observe effectively, you need to know what you're looking for. If you're going to see, you need to know what you're looking for. We're talking about reading the Bible, how to read the Bible. The first week we talked about the Spirit, that it's a supernatural thing. The second week we talked about story, that there's this great grand story and you need to know the whole context of it. Today we're going to talk about seeing. We're going to talk about observing the text, because Bible reading is really three things: observation, interpretation, application. Observation, interpretation, application. Today we're going to focus on observation. You must take notes today. Take out something to write down this stuff, because this is one of these sermons that when you get to the end of it, if you didn't take notes, you'll go, oh, I should have taken notes. If you take notes, you will have a tool that will help you, I think, for the rest of your life. So I need you to interact with me. I need you to be actively involved in the message today, because what I'm going to do is I'm going to teach you what to look for. I'm going to teach you what to look for. I'm going to tell you what to observe so that you know what to see. It's like we're Bible detectives and we're asking questions of the text and we're looking for answers and we're marking up our Bible. You see, if we want to hear God speak to us, we have to learn to see when we read. And this sounds strange, but it's true. Write this down. If you want to see when you read, then you have to read with your hands. You have to read with your hands. If you read just with your eyes, you'll drift. If you read with your eyes and your hands, you will see. I'm going to teach you how to mark your Bible today. Now, for some of you, you say, oh, I'm not going to write my Bible. It's holy. It's sacred. Please hear me. If ever there was a book that was designed to be interacted with, it is your Bible. God wants you to interact, and the way you interact with the written word is you write too. So from this day forward, we're going to mark up our Bible. I'm going to teach you how to do it and what to look for, okay? So start writing this stuff down and we'll learn together. I am indebted to Howard Hendricks, Dr. Howard Hendricks. His book, Living by the Book, was the source for much of what I'm going to share with you today. I certainly want to give him credit for that. Here's the first thing we need to look for: things that are emphasized. Things that are emphasized. There's different strategies that the biblical writers used to emphasize certain things. One of them was that they would use more space for the important stuff. So write down the amount of space dedicated. The amount of space dedicated. I'm going to show you little symbols that you can use when you're marking your Bible for each of these things. So when you're reading something in Paul's letter, for example, and you see him dedicate a lot of space to a certain topic, just do this on the side. Just draw a bracket like that and then label whatever it is. Because Paul, when he really wanted to focus you on something, dedicated a lot of space to it. Many of the biblical writers did this. For example, you're reading in Genesis, and in Genesis chapters 1 through 11, you will find the creation of the world, the fall of mankind, the flood. You'll find the Tower of Babel. All that happens in the first 11 chapters, right? And then in chapters 12 through 50, Moses talks about a family. Abraham and his son Isaac and his son Jacob and his son Joseph. 38 chapters dedicated to a family. 11 chapters to creation, fall, flood. 38 chapters to a family. Just look in that. What do you think he's emphasizing? The family. Why? Because from this family will come the solution to the problem that is found in the first 11 chapters of Genesis. So you look at what they give a lot of space to, and that is usually something that they're emphasizing, okay? A second way that they emphasize is with the order in which they put things. Sequencing matters. Order matters. When something comes first, make sure you take note of the fact that it came first. When something comes second, make sure you take note of the fact that it came second. One way that you can do this is when you see a sequence, you can put a box around it and just put first over it. And then the next thing, put a box around it and put second. And then if there's four or five things, you just keep putting boxes and keep putting the number that is next to it. We can learn a lot of theology by how things are sequenced. Let me give you an example. In Genesis chapter 2, we see a closer view of the creation of man and woman, and God institutes marriage. He talks about the two becoming one flesh and having this incredible intimate relationship, right? Then in chapter 3, the fall happens, and everything's messed up. Our relationship with God is, and our relationship with one another. And one of the results of the fall is described in chapter 3, verse 16. Listen to these words. To the woman, he said, I will greatly increase your pains in childbearing. That's one of the results of the fall. With pain, you will give birth to children. Your desire will be for your husband, and he will rule over you. That little phrase, your desire will be for your husband, could be translated, your desire will be to rule over your husband, and he will rule over you. And so here, one of the results of the fall is that in the home, we'll start to bicker about who's in charge. We'll start to get angry about that. We'll start to try and figure out who's in charge and who's not. And that's important to know, because back in the beginning when marriage was instituted, there was none of that stuff. It was all about oneness. It was all about two people becoming one. And so we realize that Jesus came to reverse the effects of the fall, right? And so if we're walking in the Spirit, if we're living the way marriage was supposed to be lived, we won't be fighting about who's in charge. We'll be experiencing true oneness. You see, sequencing matters. We've got to know what comes first and what comes second, okay? Number two, write this down. Things that are repeated. You need to take note of things that are repeated. I learned early on when I was learning how to teach that one of the most effective tools for teaching someone is to repeat what you just said. If you want people to get it, repeat it. If you want people to get it, repeat it. Repeat it. If you want people to get it, you can even flip it like that if you want. But if you really want people to get it, repeat it. The biblical writers knew this. Jesus knew this. This week, as you're reading chapter by chapter with the whole church, you're going to read through what's called the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew's gospel. And you're going to see a number of times Jesus say the same thing. He repeats it. He who has ears, let him hear. He who has ears, let him hear. What's he saying? Hey, if you're listening, really listen. Own this. Receive it. He who has ears, let him hear. What's really cool is then when you read in the book of Revelation, which was written by one of his disciples, John, almost 50 years later, in the first, second and third chapters, he's writing letters to the different churches, and you know what he says? He who has ears, let him hear what the Spirit has to say to the church in Ephesus. He who has ears, let him hear. 50 years later, it was still stuck in his head. Why? Because Jesus just said it over and over and over and over and over again. When you want to learn something, repeat it. When you want to teach something, repeat it. So the biblical writers do this. So whenever you're reading a text, one of the things you're looking for are words, concepts, phrases that are repeated, and you want to take note of those. How do you do that? It's similar to this, what I just described. The first time you see it, you put a box around it, or you put a circle around it and just put a one. Second time, two, three. And at the end of it, you'll not only see where all the repeated words are, but you'll have a catalog of just how many times it is repeated. Let me show you an example. Tell me if you know what the theme is in Psalm 136 as I read it to you. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Give thanks to the God of gods. His love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord of lords. His love endures forever. To him alone who does great wonders, his love endures forever. What's his theme? Enduring love? Enduring love forever? What's the other theme? Give thanks. So what he's trying to remind us of is God's love never ends, and the appropriate response to that is thanks. It's not hard to figure out when you see something that's repeated. That's obviously a very obvious example. 26 times in that passage he says his love endures forever. It's a little more subtle in other places. I just wanted to use the obvious example for you so you could see it. Third thing, write this down. Things that are related. We need to look for things that are related. Once again, the authors used various strategies to show us things that are related. One is called movement from general to specific. So the author will tell you the general principle or the general statement, and then we'll show you specific examples of that. One example would be in Matthew 6. You'll be reading this week. Be careful not to do your acts of righteousness before men to be seen by them. If you do, you will have received your reward from the Father. You will receive no reward from your Father in heaven. General principle, don't do self-righteous acts before people. Don't do things so that people notice you. General principle. Then, in verses 2 through 4 of Matthew 6, he uses an example of giving so that people notice. And then in verses 5 through 15, praying so that people notice. And then in verses 16 through 18, fasting so people notice. So here's what we do with this. When we see something that's kind of the general statement, in the margin we'll do a Roman numeral 1 because we're going to build an outline in the margin. OK, Okay, so don't do things so that other people notice. And then we'll keep reading. We'll see, oh, giving. Okay, so that's A, giving. And we'll just write it right there in the margin. And then, oh, we notice praying. We'll do B, praying. And then we'll notice, oh, fasting. And we'll do C, fasting. Right there in your margin, you're building a sermon outline. Did you know you could build sermon outline? It's not hard. It's just noticing what's already there. Here's the general statement, and here's the specifics that point to that general statement. And another thing to look for, and this is another way that biblical writers relate things, is questions and answers. Questions and answers. Here's the symbol whenever you see a question. You probably can guess it. I'm just going to draw a question mark. Whenever you see a question, draw a question mark right over it. So in Romans, the Apostle Paul is teaching about grace and how grace is free. And we get to Romans chapter 6, verse 1, and what does he say? He anticipates our question. And he says, what shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? And then at the beginning of verse 2, he answers it, by no means! And he goes on to describe why we don't live that way. So we put the question mark over the question, and then when he gives us the answer, we just put an A over that, and we draw an arrow line like that between the question and the answer, because we want to be noticing when they ask questions, because it's showing us that things are related. Now, there's a third kind of relation I want you to keep your eyes open for. It's called cause and effect. Cause and effect. Remember learning about this when you were younger? It's the billiard ball principle. You've got a cue ball, and you hit the cue ball, and it goes traveling across and hits another ball, and then that ball goes a different direction because the cue ball hit it. The cue ball is the cause, and the impact it has on those other balls, that's the effect. And this happens in Scripture all the time. The writers will tell us something, and then they'll tell us, here's the effect, or here's the result, because that thing is true. Whenever we see in a cause an effect, the way I just deal with it is I'll put a circle around the cause, and then out in the margin, I'll write cause. And then I'll find the effects, and I'll circle that, and I'll just draw arrows like this. So we're seeing, maybe on the next line it's down here, so we're seeing the cause and the effects. And your Bible's getting messy. Please hear me. A messy Bible is a beautiful Bible. Messy Bibles are good. Because you'll be able to come back to this text 5 years later, and you'll instantly see your notes, and you'll be drawn right back into where you were five years earlier. Because we're reading with our hands and not just with our eyes. Let me give you an example of cause and effect. Psalm 1:1. See if you can note the cause and the effect here. Blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners, or sit in the seat of mockers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. There's your cause. Someone who just spends time in the Word, meditating in the Word of God. He is like a tree planted by the streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever he does prospers. There's the effect. This guy spends a lot of time in God's Word. Look what happens. He's like a tree. He's alive. This fruit being brought through him and through her. Leaves that don't wither. Prosperity. I mean, that's a cool cause and effect kind of passage. This happens all over Scripture. Whenever you see a cause, make sure you're looking for the effect. Okay? Number four. I know we're flying through this. The reason I'm flying through it is because I want to show you an example before we leave. Things that are compared. Things that are compared. The biblical writers do this all the time as well. They say such and such is like something else. They use two specific tools to do this. One is called a simile. Remember this from English comp class? A simile is a word picture that compares things using two little words. What are the words? Do you remember? Like and as. You guys listened. Way to go. So whenever you see the word as or like, you go simile. Simile. So you find as. You see it in the text. You put a circle around it. You draw an arrow out to the margin, and you write S-I-M, or you can write the whole word out if you know how to spell it, simile. Psalm 42:1, listen. As the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul longs for you, O Lord. It's a simile. In the same way a deer pants for water, my soul pants for you. Okay, so what do we do when we see a simile? We stop and we start using our imagination. We start asking the question, well, what does a deer panting for water look like? We imagine a little deer in the desert, just parched little deer throat. little deer. He's got the big, huge feet, too big for him, you know, and he's looking around for water, and his legs are starting to wobble. And all of a sudden, he sees some water, a little pond of water, and he starts galloping over towards the water, right? And he just dives into the water, and he's just sucking up the water. It's like, oh, I'm parched, I'm dry, I just long for this water. And as a deer pants for water, so my soul longs for you, O Lord. And as we're reading it, I'm thinking, my soul doesn't really pant for you like that, Jesus. And I start to have a conversation. What's wrong? What's blocking my connection with you? What's blocking my interaction with you? And all of a sudden, I'm not reading anymore. I'm interacting, and the Holy Spirit's doing his work. And all because I took note of a simile. We've got to look for these things. We've got to see them. There's another figure of speech that's like a simile. Remember what it's called? Metaphor. And what's a metaphor? Met. Okay, so we see it, and we can circle it, and we can draw an arrow out to the margin. But a metaphor is a little harder to see the simile because you don't have the ask and the like, but it's the comparison of two things. So Jesus said, I am the vine, you are the branches. Right? I am the vine, my Father is the gardener. It's a metaphor. He's obviously not a vine, literally. It's a metaphor. Jesus does this brilliantly in John chapter 3, one of the most famous passages in all of Scripture. Remember, he has this conversation with Nicodemus, and he says, you know, a woman must be born again. It's a metaphor. You've got to be born again. The problem was Nicodemus didn't realize it was a metaphor. So Nicodemus says, how can a man be born when he's old? Surely he cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb to be born? You can just see Jesus going, it's a metaphor. It's a metaphor. Not literally born again. And so Jesus has to just lay it out for Nicodemus. Jesus said, I tell you the truth. No one can enter the kingdom of God unless he's born of water and the Spirit. And then Jesus uses a simile. Aren't you glad you know this? Because the next time you read John 3, you'll see the metaphors and similes all over the place. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up. So Jesus is making a comparison between that story in Numbers 21 when the snake was lifted up in the wilderness and his own crucifixion. And so that just draws you back to Numbers 21 and you start diving into that and saying, Lord, how are these things the same? And all of a sudden you're studying God's word and you're interacting with him all because you are looking for metaphors and similes. Comparisons. By the way, there's tons of metaphors and similes in the Proverbs and in the Psalms. You'll see them a lot in that specific portion of Scripture. Number five, things that are contrasted. So we have things that are compared, now things that are contrasted. There's one word that almost always brings about contrast in Scripture, and that's the word but. And I've told you it's one of my favorite words because usually it's almost always bad news, but now good news. And so the contrast is between bad news and good news. So Romans 3:20 is a great example. Therefore, no one will be declared righteous in his sight by observing the law. Bad news. No one can be declared righteous by doing things. But now, verse 21 says this, but now a righteousness from God apart from law has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. So bad news, no one can earn God's favor. Good news, God is granting it. A righteousness from him has come. Whenever you see the word but, stop and ask yourself, what contrast is being made? Here's what I do when I find a contrast word. I do an exclamation point, and then I draw an arrow going this way and an arrow going this way. And what that tells me is there's a contrast here, so what comes before it is different from what comes after it. And I want to make sure I'm taking note of the contrast. Number six. Things you never want to miss. This is kind of my catch-all. Things you never want to miss. I can still remember as a 9-year-old boy telling my mother one day, I want to learn how to read the Bible. She said, go and get your coloring stuff and your Bible. My coloring stuff, your crayons or your color pencils and your Bible. I said, I don't want to draw, I want to read the Bible. Just get it. So I got my Bible out and I got my colored pencils out and she taught me how to color code my Bible. Taught me how to color code my Bible. So let me tell you what she told me a few years ago, all right? We've got four colors, blue, red, green, and yellow. Okay, so blue we will use whenever God shows up. Whenever God shows up in Scripture, now we have God the Father, God the Son, and God the Spirit. So we'll not only use blue, but we'll use a symbol too. If it's God the Father, we'll put an F. If it's God the Spirit, we'll put an S. And if it's God the Son, if it's Jesus, we'll use a cross. And so we'll underline it in blue, and then we'll use that symbol because we want to see where Christ is. We want to see where God is in every passage that we read. Red represents warnings. Warnings. There are warnings all over Scripture. And when you underline them in red, it's amazing. You'll be paging through Scripture, and the red will just jump off the page. And every once in a while, you'll be just paging through, and the Holy Spirit will have a specific warning for you, and it'll jump off the page, and you'll see it because it was underlined in red, and you'll be said, so glad I took notes that day at church so I could do it in red. Because now I can see it, all right? Green is promises or blessings. Maybe you're really discouraged, and you just want to see some promises from the Lord for you, so you can just start paging through Scripture and looking for the green that you've taken time to underline. And then yellow, I've got orange up here because I don't have a yellow pen. Yellow is commands. When the biblical writers tell us how to respond to the teaching in certain ways, we underline them in yellow, okay? You got all that? We've got 10 minutes left. We're going to practice this together. I'm going to show you how it works, all right? So I ask you to turn to Colossians chapter 2. And I'm really hoping it's on here. Yes! Here's Colossians chapter 2. Okay, let me read it to you first with my mouth, and then we'll read it with our hands, all right? Go ahead and turn to it. We're going to mark up your Bible. If you never marked up your Bible before, there's a first day for everything, and this is it, all right? Colossians 2, 6. So then, just as you received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the basic principles of this world, rather than on Christ. For in Christ all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form, and you have been given fullness in Christ, who is the head over every power and authority. Now for some of you, let's be honest, even as I was reading that, you were drifting, weren't you? You were. You were thinking about lunch. Can I get to Luby's before everyone else in this place? You're starting to drift. That's because you're not reading with your hands. So let's do it again, and let's read with our hands. All right? Let's think through what we have to look for. Is there something in here that Paul gives more space to? We're going to look for space dedicated. And because we're low on time, I'll just tell you there isn't. It's pretty even all the way through. So we'll go to the next question. Is there any sequence represented in this? Is there anything that happens first and then happens second? Any ideas? What's that? Receive Christ first, right? Okay, so we're going to put a box around receive Christ, and we're going to write first, and then what's second? Live in him. Thank you. Live in him. Second. So, we just learned that you receive Christ first, and then you live in him. And you're like, well, duh. No, time out a second. It's not duh for everybody. There are millions of people around the world who are trying to live the Christian life, and they haven't met him yet. They don't know him. They haven't been transformed by him yet, right? And so this is a really important sequence. Oh, I got to trust Christ first. I got to receive him. I've got to let him transform me. Then I can live in him. Look what you just learned because you were looking for sequence, all right? Next thing we're going to look for is repeated words. Any repeated words that jump out at you? Here's one, Christ. Let's circle Christ. We'll put a little one next to it. One. Okay, let's see where else Christ shows up. Here he is again. So we'll put a two there. Here he is again in verse 9. Put a three there. Shows up again a little later in verse 10. So we'll put a four there. But there's also pronouns pointing to Christ, right? So we want to make sure we note those as well. So Christ Jesus, Lord, continue to live in him. That could easily be Christ too. So we'll circle that and we'll write number 5. Rooted and built up in him. Number 6, strengthened in the faith as you were taught. And that's pretty much it. And so if you want, you can just look at these statements about Christ and you can learn a ton about him. You can see that we can receive him, that we can live in him, that we can be rooted and built up in him as well. We see that we can depend on him. We'll look at that in more in a second. We also see that he is the fullness of the deity in bodily form. Wow, that's a pretty powerful statement. And we also see that in Christ, we have fullness too. Wow, look at all you learned about Jesus just because you noted that he was repeated. There's something else repeated in here a number of times. It's a pronoun. Who is it? You. Yes. Circle the yous, all right? You. There's one. See that no one takes you. Two, captive, right? Princes of this world. I miss one. Continue to live in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith. You were taught. There you go. Okay, this is two. See, you're reading? Good job. You noticed that. I'm proud of you guys. I did that on purpose. No, I didn't. All right. Verse 10, and you have been given fullness in Christ, okay? Is that all of them? Okay, so here's what you can learn about you. You can receive Christ, right? You can be taken captive through hollow teaching. That's important to know. And you've been given fullness in Christ. That's a three-point sermon you just preached. You just found, see, sermon, it's not that hard. I'm giving you all my secrets today. It's not that hard. You just have to see, you just have to look, all right? Now we're going to look for movement from general to specific. There's another repeated word, by the way. Do it later. In. Just look for in. Circle it, and you'll be stunned at what you can learn about in and what it means in this text. Okay, but now we're moving from general to specific. You see anything from general to specific? Look at verse 8. General. See to it that no one takes you captive. Okay? So we're going to go out here, and we're going to say captive. That's Roman numeral 1, because we're going to paint a little outline out here on the side, all right? So see to it that no one takes you captive. That's the general statement. How's that going to happen? Through hollow philosophy and deceptive philosophy. So A, hollow philosophy. B, deceptive philosophy. And what kind of hollow and deceptive philosophy will we discover? That which depends on tradition and principles of the world. So we'll actually do a little one with a parenthesis, tradition and principles. And what you're doing as you're doing this is you're getting a feel for the kind of stuff that can get you off track if you're not really careful. And it's stuff that captivates you, it's hollow and it's deceptive, it's philosophical, and it's based on tradition and the principles of this world. And you can do a whole study as you dive deeper in that. We'll talk about studying Scripture a little later in our series. Right now, we're just observing, all right? So the next thing we're looking for is questions and answers. I'm almost out of time. I'll just tell you there's no questions, so we'll go to the next thing. Cause and effect. Do you see any cause and effect in our text? It's in verse 6. Here it is. We've seen this one spot here. We're going to circle live in him. I'm going to put an arrow out here, and we're going to write cause. Look what happens when we live in him. We get, and we're going to do a little arrow in a circle, rooted, and we get, arrow in a circle, built up in him. And when we live in him, we get, arrow in a circle, strengthened in the faith, as you were taught, and we find ourselves, another effect, overflowing with thankfulness. So this is awesome. As we live in him, as we experience the life of Christ, we find ourselves rooted and built up in him. We find ourselves strengthened in our walk with him, and we find ourselves overflowing with thankfulness. See how important it is to look for cause and effect as you're reading Scripture, okay? Any similes in the text? You see a simile? You see the word as anywhere? You still with me? So then, just as. There it is. So we're going to circle it. We're going to write S-I-M. Simile, so we're making a comparison. What's the comparison between? Just as you received, live. So the comparison is between received, and if you're like me, you'll just write R-E-C because you can't remember if it's I before E and except after C, and so you just abbreviate it, R-E-C, and live. This is important. He's making a comparison here. It's a big part of the text. How did you receive him? By grace through faith you received him, right? So how do you live in him? By grace through faith. That's a really important distinction, because a lot of people think you receive him by grace through faith, and then you live in him by working really hard. See how important this simile is? This simile just told us, no, you don't live in him by working really hard. You live in him by grace through faith. Any metaphors? Verse 7 has a metaphor, two metaphors. Rooted, this is a comparison word, and built up. So we're going to underline those, and we're going to write met, a four in the margin. Rooted is an agricultural metaphor. It's a picture of roots going down into the ground. Built up is an architectural metaphor. It's the picture of a foundation underneath the building. So what he's saying is that when we live in him, we have roots that go deep, and we are like a building that has a sure foundation. That's helpful to know. I'm glad I found that metaphor. Contrast. You see the word but anywhere? I'm almost out of time, so I'll tell you there's no word but in there. But there is a contrast word, or different one. Does anyone see it? Yell it out. Rather. Yes. Very good. You guys are doing great. Where's rather? Right here. Rather. Okay, so remember, when we see a contrasting word, we're going to write an exclamation point. We're going to draw an arrow this way and an arrow this way, reminding us that what comes before this point is different from what comes after this point. So what is it that comes before this point? You can depend on hollow and deceptive philosophy if you want. It depends on human tradition and basic principles. Or you can depend on Christ. That's your choice. There's a contrast there. If you want, you can follow after the junk that's out there. Or you can just always lean into Jesus and find the truth in him. That's what the contrast teaches us. Okay, now we get to the colors. We're almost done. Hang in there with me. Blue represents what? God. Okay, we've already circled Jesus each time because it's a repeating thing. But what we're going to do is we're going to underline it in blue. I'm going to draw a blue cross, just so that we can pick him out really quickly. We'll do the pronouns too. Can you see which part of the text is really, really important? This part is really, really important. There's a lot here, isn't there? Okay, we're going to underline him again here. Okay. Let me see him down here again. Let me see him here again. Let me see him here again. And so at just a glance, we can look and we can see where Jesus shows up in the text. How about a warning? Is there any warning in the text? There is. Verse 8, right? Warning! Hey, everybody, make sure, see to it, that no one takes you captive. You can underline it, you can use a red highlighter, you can do whatever you want, but make sure you see it when you come back to this text. Warning! You guys can fall flat on your face if you're not careful. Be careful. What can trip us up, Paul? Hollow and deceptive philosophy. Well, where does that come from? Human tradition and principles of this world. I need to learn more about that so I make sure I don't fall flat on my face. Okay, you're seeing things now, and you're not going to forget them because you marked them. What does green represent? Promises or blessings, right? Where's the promise or the blessing in this text? How about verse 10? I don't know if there's a greater blessing anywhere in Scripture. Look at it, folks. You, if you're in Christ, have been given fullness in Christ. Raise your hand if you're glad you've been given fullness in Christ. Oh, man, what a blessing, right? That's an amazing truth. We'll come back to it in just a second. And yellow or orange represents commands. I see two commands in the text. The first one is continue to live in him. Paul is commanding us to live by faith in grace. All right? Second command, see to it that none of you are taken captive. That's an imperative. Make sure you don't fall prey to the evil one. Okay, so we read this text with our hands instead of just with our eyes. We dove into it and we learned so much. Here's what we learned. We need to walk by grace in faith, in Christ. As we do, these things become apparent in our life. We find ourselves rooted and built up in him. We find ourselves strengthened in our faith. We find ourselves overflowing with thankfulness. But Paul says, be careful. Make sure you're aware that there's nasty, hollow, and deceptive philosophy out there that will trip you up if you depend on it. Instead, we are to depend on Christ, which is a really smart thing to do because as we continue, we discover that Christ is the fullness of God in bodily form. He is fully God. And not only that, he, in his infinite grace, has given us fullness in Christ. So why in the world would we chase after hollow, silly, deceptive, broken philosophies? When we've got Jesus, we've got all we need. Stand with me. I want to pray for you. I know we went through that really fast. That's why I asked you to take notes. Here's your assignment for the week. You're going to be reading through Matthew as we read through God's Word together. If you don't know what the chapters are, go to our webpage and just click on the blog, and they're all listed there, btbf.org. You're going to be reading through Matthew. You'll be through the Sermon on the Mount. The Sermon on the Mount is a great place to practice this. So when you read your chapters this week, have your colored pencils, have your pen, mark up your Bible, and then find a friend, a spouse, a brother, a sister, a mom or dad, and just both get your Bibles out and say, let me show you what I marked, show me what you marked, and have a conversation about what you marked. Talking about what you're learning in Scripture isn't rocket science, folks. It's just seeing things carefully. Let me pray for you. Lord, thank you for my people. Thank you that they have a heart to know you, to walk closely with you, to be intimate with you. Thank you that you have given us a means, an amazing means, in this thing called the Bible. This living, active, Holy Spirit-inspired, Holy Spirit-illuminated work. Your love letter to us. Thank you, Jesus. I pray that we would engage in our reading, that we would really engage with the Word. Pray that we'd read with our hands from this day forth, that we'd mark up our Bibles so we'd be able to be reminded of what we've read, we'd be able to dive deep into what you want to say to us. Lord Jesus, thank you for this time in your Word. I pray these things in your name. Amen. Please note, we just went through that whole text. You have a pretty deep understanding of that text now, right? I didn't mention Greek once. Not once. I didn't mention Greek once. I didn't quote any theologians. I didn't quote any commentators. I didn't have to go to any books to see this stuff. I just had to look and see. You can do this. You don't need a seminary degree. You don't need to be a rocket scientist. You don't need a PhD in theology. You can read the Bible if you read with your hands. Have a great week reading the Bible, and we'll see you next Sunday. God bless.